for the first time, and those who are ready, it's good to have you with us. If you are here today for Sunday club, now is the point to disappear the meal through into the main chapel.
By the mercy of God, let us confess our sins and present our body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to Him, which is our spiritual worship, first keeping a moment of quiet reflection.
The Lord enrich you with his grace and nourish you with his blessing. The Lord defend you in trouble and keep you from falling. The Lord accept your prayers and absolve you from your offense.
Obedience, was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ. Shows procession through the church at the end of the service. The local bishop is at the back of the procession. And as it's about to come past, two spinster sisters gleefully dart out across the aisle in front of him, whilst he glares at them. Capture says the two sisters had loved playing chicken from childhood. Well, that's one form of temptation, should we actually do that. But there's another. One example would be Mrs. Doyle, the somewhat demented housekeeper for fathers Ted, Dougal and Jack in the 1990 television comedy Father Ted. In it, Mrs. Doyle constantly tries to persuade Father Ted to have enough routine out of him, or to Bishop Brennan, encouraging him to have another biscuit. Go in now, Father, go on, go on now, go on. Yet, of course, there is one which is even more insidious. For how many advertising agencies have in effect used Mrs. Doyle's line with such phrases as, "Go on, you know you have just what you want." You can have it, because we have it right here. And only for £99.99. Or perhaps naughty, but nice. Because you're worth it. Such approaches can encourage us to think that we are in total charge. The difficult thing for us to accept is that practices which look innocent enough at the start can take our personality and end up making us acquisitive and selfish. We live in a time when denying ourselves anything is apparently hard work. But in Christ's temptations, we may discover more of a shared experience than we might at first realise. At that moment, all possibilities seem open to him, as they often seem to us. So can we learn from these experiences how we should respond? In this space between his baptism and the start of his public ministry, Jesus spends time in solitude in the desert, focusing on God, his Father, and prepare for his upcoming ministry. We're told that during this time, three different temptations were placed before him. The first prompted him to satisfy a physical need, hunger. The second, more daring and is often aware of temptation, offered him seemingly great personal power, whilst the third and final one urged him to prove his identity as the Son of God. And those three temptations were proposed quite deliberately by God's adversary, the devil. At that moment, Jesus finds himself in a similar position to that of Adam in the Garden of Eden. Can he resist, thus fulfilling God's true purposes for him? Or will he succumb? So let's look briefly at those three temptations. We're told he was in the desert for 40 days. We don't know that it was actually 40 days as we understand 40 days now. We know that it would have been for a long period of time. And in that long period of time, he was fasting. The Eastern Orthodox Christians use fasting as a means for focusing their prayers. This was something else. For at the end of the 40 days, or however long that period was, he must have been physically exhausted. Famish doesn't do it justice. The devil, whatever form it took, would have been all too aware of this, and Jesus is enticed to feed himself on stone turned to bread. This might seem reasonable, yet he'd be encouraged to flout the very laws of nature. Don't normally transform stone into bread. As he were to give in to that temptation, he would have perverted the physical properties of nature as ordained by God his Father. He'd also be denying the humanity he shared with us. For after all, how many of us can make a loaf of bread out of a lump of stone? The second temptation offers Jesus earthly power. In fact, the kind of kingdom he claimed neither his own or to seek. Yet to gain it, he would have had to serve a totally unworthy master. And the power gained would be a mere illusion, saying, yes, would also be to reject the role God had given him and thus failing to fulfill his purposes. And then the final temptation calls on Jesus to assert himself, to prove who he really is. It's an appeal to the most fundamental weakness of human nature, egocentricity. You tell me you're God's son, go on. Prove it. dead. Jesus is offered a chance to flaunt his own identity, to be revealed as God in his own moment. Now this foreshadows the ultimate test of Christ's obedience and faithfulness to God's servant. For Jesus' response will be echoed just a few years later in his passion and death. Living in the world presents us with similar temptations, although most of the time we're hardly aware of them. Dragged along by prevailing culture, we're not always aware that, in different ways, we're still playing chicken. It takes very little to get immersed into that game. For we routinely aim to satisfy our own physical needs and desires first and foremost. Some will often crave worldly status and power over others. And most of all, we want to stress our uniqueness over other beings, mortal or otherwise. Without realizing it, we can be tempted to make ourselves gods. Lent, however, offers us one of the sanctuaries of the Christian year. It's a time when we can stand back from the hurly-burly of our usual activities and reflect on our daily lives and on our ongoing, deepening relationship with God. Are we the kind of people who try and cross patience by thoughtless or willful disobedience? How have we failed to be the people God made us to be? Can we change? Jesus, the Gospel tells us, spent that period of time in the wilderness, a bleak and barren place of being, a place free from worldly distractions. The 3rd century St. Anthony of Egypt, regarded as the founder of Christian monasticism, was the son of wealthy landowners from Lower Egypt, who, after his parents' death, sold the family estate, gave the large amount of money to the poor, and became a monk. Known for his holiness and the simplicity of his life, Anthony became something of a celebrity. So to escape this celebrity status, he took himself out into the Egyptian desert. Yet the crowds followed him. So to deal with them, he formed them into a community, living something of a solitary life, in cells scattered around, but coming together for the Eucharist once a week. That same monastery is still functioning and blossoming, the oldest existing Christian monastery in the world. Copts still lead the hustle and bustle of life Cairo and other Egyptian cities and flee to the desert after the example of St. Anthony. In that place, in that solitude where there is nothing, there's a real need to place all of one's trust and hope in God, to focus entirely on Him. In a way, Lent can be that place for us. How seriously we attempt to encounter our spiritual wilderness, where our souls can be still, apart from life's encumbrances and its distractions, where we can wait on God, is partly a matter of choice. Yet, our most tentative prayer can open us to God. Contemplation, however brief, may allow prompting by the Holy Spirit. Perhaps if we journey well through Lent, perhaps one day we may discover that winner of the game of chicken is usually the one who refuses to play at all. Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. The words, Lord of compassion, please respond, in your mercy, hear us. Lord of compassion,
in your mercy, hear us.
As your church begins this season of Lent, we ask you to remind us of what is important and what is not, of where we are wandering away and where we need to change, so that by Easter we will be renewed and strengthened for your service in the world. Lord of compassion,
in your mercy, hear us.
Father, your world's misery and pain and desperate need of healing are clear to see and affect us all. We pray now for your damaged world, with all its weakness, longings and failure, with all its potential and hope. We pray for all whom you call to occupy positions of political leadership. Lord of compassion,
in your mercy.
Wherever a child is born, we celebrate your creative hope. And so we pray for all to be born this week, for their families and communities, that all our children may be loved and cared for, safe and happy. We pray for the work of our Sunday club, for our schools, and all who cross the parish in different ways work with young people. Lord of compassion, Father, we pray for all who suffer through others' sin, all victims of abuse or oppression or act, all whose adult lives are distorted and misshapen by early damaging experience which need your healing. We remember those who are sick, in mind, body or spirit, or those whose names are laid upon the altars of this church. The Sally, Mindy, Matrix, Roy, Royalist, Galen, Rachel Owen, Robbie Bowen. Lord of compassion, Father, we remember those who, freed from the aging and pain of their bodies, now live with you in the peace and joy of God. We give thanks for all who have walked with us the way of death, for past members and benefactors of this church and parish, for all who lie within this church and churchyard. Lord of compassion,
in your mercy.
Father, we give you thanks and praise for the hope we have in your Son Jesus, for the strength to resist temptation, and the joy and relief of forgiveness when we fall. So rejoicing in the prayers of Blessed Mary and the whole community of faith, we gather together these and all of our prayers as we pray. Merciful Father, accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always
with us.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Amen.
God of the dead, as we follow Jesus into the unknown, may we recognize the tempter when he comes. Let it be your bread, your world be served, as you alone we work. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. He gave the praise, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this for me. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is therefore you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink, in remembrance of me. So far, we remember all that Jesus did. In him, we feel confident his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing for you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory.
Lord God, you have renewed us the living bread of heaven. By it, you nourish our faith, increase our faith, and strengthen our love. Teach us always to hunger for him who is the true and living bread, and enable us to live by every word that proceeds from out of your mouth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please do read the notice sheet for the week. Either take a copy away or have a look at it online, both on the website and Facebook. Just one or two things very briefly draw to your attention. Part of our Lenten discipline is study, and we have the first of our Lenten Bible services coming Wednesday here in the church, led by Pastor Laura, and that's 6:30. And throughout the course of that, the weekly Bible study will be looking at the Gospel for the following Sunday, so you get an insight into what whichever one of us is going to be preaching might possibly be preaching about. That's on Wednesday evening, and then that's Friday the 1st, this coming Friday the 2nd, of our Station of the Cross at 12:30. Next Sunday is the final Sunday you'll be able to order a real Easter egg, and for yourself or someone else. And the information for that is over on the table in the refreshment area. Please do complete one of the order forms, pop it in the box. I will give the money to Marion directly, or if you pay by contactless, if you let Marion know that. But next Sunday is the last Sunday, and that's because after that we ought to get free delivery. So we're getting our Easter break delivery in early, as it were. And two other things to draw to your attention, or three things. Just another reminder about the parish contact list. If you've not completed one of the forms yet, so we can keep in touch with you, let you know if you change things again, please do fill one out. The Marion, and we are at that time of the year when we are checking the electoral roll in readiness for the annual parochial meeting at the beginning of next month. Again, if you want to check that you are on the roll, have a word with Marion. We will let you know that she has access to it on the parish computer. And if you're not there, please do fill out all the forms and pop it in the box. Can I just emphasise, it is not the same as the electoral roll that you complete for the local authority. Nothing to do with electing councillors or big elections or anything else like that. It's the nearest thing that the Church of England has to a membership list. So if you worship here regularly, we do encourage you to complete one of those. And then, looking forward to the 1st of April, having our next spring clean to get the place spick and span, reaching all the high places, knocking down, doing all the things that we do during the week, but on a bigger scale, ready for Holy Week and Easter. That's on Saturday, the 1st of April, starts at 9:30, and there will be a light lunch provided as well. So do book the date, come along, age, etc., don't matter. We've had Joseph here doing it before, so come along on 1st of April. Think those are all the notes. Just to say there are refreshments. As usual, please do stay for some of the eat and drink. And if you need to indicate your presence here for application for the school, don't forget to sign up as you need. Sign up here, what's happening in Sunday lunch.
Good morning.
Lord be with
you. And with thy spirit.
Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow it. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you this Lent and always.
Amen. Ended. Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.